Interested in your family life, mate. No, sir, it's not a very interesting subject. I really think it myself.
Very natural, I'm sure. That will do, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Lang's views on marriage seem somewhat lax. Really, if the lower orders don't set us a good example. What on earth is the use of them?
Mr. Earnest Worthing.
Ah! How are you, my dear Earnest? Oh!
What brings you up to
that? Oh, pleasure, pleasure. What else should bring one anywhere? Hello. Why all these cups? Why cucumber sandwiches? Why such reckless extravagance in one so young? Who is coming to tea here, Algernon?
Oh, nearly Aunt Augusta.
Oh.
And Gwendolyn.
How perfectly delightful.
My dear fellow, the way you flirt with Gwendolyn is perfectly disgraceful. It's almost as bad as the way Gwendolyn flirts with you.
Well, I am in love with Gwendolyn. I have come up to town expressly to propose to her.
I want you to come up for pleasure. I do that business.
Please! Don't touch the cucumber sandwiches!
They will be specially for Aunt Augusta.
But you've been eating them this whole time!
That is quite a different matter. She is my aunt! How's the bread and butter? The bread and butter is for Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn is devoted to bread and butter.
Oh, very good bread and butter it is too.
My dear fellow, you need not eat as if you were going to eat at all. You behave as if you are married to her already. You are not married to her already, and I don't think you ever will be.
And why on earth do you say that?
I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
My dear fellow, Gwendolyn is my first cousin, and before I allow you to marry her, you have to throw up the whole question of obsessively.
Settling. What on earth do you mean, Algernon, by settling? I don't know anybody by the name of Settling.
Room key, that cigarette case, Mr. Worthing left in the smoking room the last time he died
here. You mean to tell me that you have my cigarette case this whole time? I wish to goodness you'd have let me know. I've been writing frantic letters to Scotland Yard about it. I was very nearly offering a large reward.
Yes. But this isn't your cigarette case. This cigarette case is addressed to someone with the name of Cecily. And you said you didn't know anyone of that name.
Yes, well, if you must have known, Cecily happens to be my aunt.
And your aunt?
Yes. Charming lady she is too, lives in Tunbridge Wells.
Now just keep back! Why does she call herself Little Cecily if she is your aunt and lives at Tunbridge Wells? From Little Cecily?
With her fondest love. My dear fellow, I don't see what's in that at all. Some aunts are tall and some aunts are not tall. Surely that is a matter an aunt may be allowed to decide for herself.
Yes, why does your aunt call you her aunt? From Little Cecily? With her fondest love to her dear Uncle Jack. Besides, your name isn't Jack at all. It's Ernest.
It isn't Ernest. It's Jack.
You have always told me it was Ernest. I have introduced you to everyone as Ernest. You answer to the name of Ernest. You look as if your name was Ernest. You are the most Ernest-looking person I ever saw in my life.
Yes, well, it's Ernest in town, Jack in the country, and the cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but that does not explain the fact that your small aunt Cecily lives at Tunbridge Wells. Of course, you her dear uncle. Go on, tell me the whole thing. I may mention, I've always suspected you of being a confirmed and secret Bunburyist. And I'm quite sure now.
Bunburyist? What on earth is a Bunburyist?
I'll reveal to you the meaning of that incomparable expression as soon as you are kind enough to inform me why you are Ernest in town and Jack in the country.
Well, produce my cigarette case first.
Here it is. Now produce your explanation and pray make it improbable.
No, my dear boy. Unfortunately, there is nothing improbable about my explanation. In fact, it's rather ordinary. You see, the late Mr. Thomas Cardew, who took me in when I was a small boy, made me, in his will, guardian to his grand daughter, Miss Cecily, can't you? Cecily, who refers to me as uncle out of motives of respect that you could not possibly appreciate, lives with me in the country under the charge of her admirable governess, Miss Prism.
Where is that place in the country, by the way?
That is nothing to you, dear boy. You're not going to be invited.
But go on! Why are you Earnest in town, in Jack's country?
Dear Algy, I doubt that you'll ever be able to understand my real motives. You are hardly serious enough. You see, when one is placed in the position of guardian, one must adopt a high moral tone on all subjects. It is one's duty to do so. And since a high moral tone can hardly be said to conduce much to one's health or one's happiness, in order to get up to town, I have always pretended to have a brother by the name of Earnest living in Albany and getting into dreadful scrapes. That, my dear Algy, is the whole truth, pure and simple.
The truth is rarely pure and never simple. What you really are is a bunburyist. I was quite right in saying you were a bunburyist. You are one of the most advanced bunburyists I know.
What on earth do you want about it?
You have invented a very useful brother called Earnest. I have invented an invaluable permanent invalid called Bunbury. Bunbury is perfectly invaluable.
Developments, and I intend to develop in many directions.
twice.
No cucumbers?
No, sir, not even for any money.
That'll do, then.
Thanks, sir.
I'm greatly distressed, Aunt Professor, about there being no cucumbers, not even for ready money.
It really makes no matter, John. Thank you. I have quite a treat for you tonight. I am going to send you down with Mary Farker. She's such a delightful woman and so attentive to us, but it's delightful to watch
her. I'm afraid, Aunt Professor, I shall give up the pleasure of dining with you tonight after all.
I should hope not, Algernon. You would put my table completely out. Your uncle will have to dine upstairs. Fortunately, he's accustomed to that.
It is a great bore, and I can hardly say terrible disappointment. But the fact is, I've just received a telegram to say that my poor friend Bunbury is very ill again. They seem to think I should be with him.
It is very strange. This Mr. Bunbury seems to suffer from curiously bad health.
Yes, poor Bunbury is a dreadful.
Well, I must say, Algernon, that I think it is high time that this Mr. Bunbury made up his mind whether he was going to live or die. This shilly-shallying of the question is absurd. I would be much obliged if you would ask Mr. Bunbury, from me, not to have a relapse on Saturday. For I rely on you to arrange my music for me.
I'll speak to Bunbury, Aunt Augusta. Of course, the music is a great difficulty. You see, if one plays good music, people don't listen. If one plays bad music, people don't talk. But I'll run over the program, after all, and I'll find them for the next room for a
moment. Thank you, Algernon. It's very kind of you. Gwendolyn, you will accompany me.
Yes, Mama.
Miss Fairfax.
Great! Talking about the weather, Mr. Worthing. Whenever someone talks to me about the weather, I always feel quite certain they mean something else. That makes me so nervous.
John, as I pity any woman who is married to a man called John. No, the only really
Gwendolyn, I must get christened at once. I mean, we must get married at once.
Married, Mr. Worthing?
Why, yes. You know that I love you, and you've led me to believe, Miss Fairfax, that you are not completely indifferent to me.
Well, I adore you, but you haven't proposed to me yet. Now that all has been said about marriage, the subject has not even been touched on.
Well, may I propose to you now?
Lost.
both my parents, Lady Brown.
To lose one parent, Mr. Worthy, may be regarded as a misfortune. To lose both looks like carelessness. Who was your father?
I'm afraid I don't really know. You see, Lady Bracknell, I said that I had lost both of my parents when it would probably be closer to the truth to say that my parents have lost me. You see, I was found.
Found?
Yes, the late Mr. Thomas Cardew found me and then gave me the name of Worthing because he had a ticket for Worthing in his pocket at the time. Worthing is a charming place in Sussex. It's a seaside resort.
And where did this charitable gentleman who had a first class seat to a seaside resort find you?
In a handbag. Yes, Lady Bracknell, I was found in a handbag. Somewhat. Large black leather handbag, handles to it. A rather ordinary handbag, in fact.
In what locality is this Mr. James?
Thomas.
Thomas Cardew, find this ordinary handbag.
In the cloakroom at Victoria Station. It was given to him in mistake for a reserve.
The cloakroom of Victoria Station.
Why, yes. The bride.
The line is immaterial, Mr. Worthy. As for the particular locality in which the handbag was found, the cloakroom of the railway station may serve to conceal a social indiscretion. Hairs probably indeed been used for that purpose before now, and it can hardly be regarded as an assured basis for a recognized position in good society.
Well then, can I ask what you would advise me to do? I can tell you I would do anything to ensure Gwendolyn's happiness.
I advise you, Mr. Worthy, to try and acquire some relations as soon as possible.
I don't see how you can possibly expect me to do that. I can get the handbag at any moment. It's in my cloakroom at home. I really think that should satisfy you, Lady Brown.
Me, sir? Well, what does it cost you of me? You hardly think that I, a Lord Petmore, would let our only daughter, a girl brought up with the utmost care, marry into a cloakroom and form an alliance with a parcel? Good afternoon, Mr. Worthy.
Good afternoon.
Didn't it go off all right, old boy? You don't mean to say Gwendolyn refused you?
Oh, no. As far as she's concerned, we're already engaged. Her mother is perfectly unbearable. I've never met such a Gorgon. I'm not really quite sure what a Gorgon is, but Lady Bracknell seems to me to be one. At any rate, she's a monster without being a myth, which is rather unfair. Oh, I'm sorry, Archie. I probably shouldn't talk about your arms in front of you in some ways.
My dear boy, I love hearing my relations' views.
You don't think there's any chance of Gwendolyn becoming like her mother in, say, 150 years of your life?
All women become like their mothers. That's their tragedy. No man does. That's his.
Is that supposed to be...
Oh, it is perfectly phrased! And quite as true as any observation in civilized life should be.
Well, I am sick to death of cleverness. Everybody's clever nowadays. You can't go anywhere without meeting clever people.
By the way, did you tell Gwendolyn the truth yet about your being Earnest in town and Jackie the country?
The truth is not quite the sort of thing one tells a sweet, nice, innocent girl such as Gwendolyn. What ideas you have on the ways to behave toward women?
The only way to behave to a woman is to make love to her if she's pretty and to someone else if she's plain.
Well, that is nonsense, Algernon.
What about your brother? What about this profligate of hers?
Oh, by the end of the week I shall have got rid of him. I'll say he died quite suddenly of apoplexy or something.
People do die quite suddenly of apoplexy, don't they?
Yes, but it's dreadful, my dear fellow. It's a sort of thing that runs in family, much better say a severe chill.
Yes, but you're sure a severe chill is not hereditary or anything of that kind?
Of course it isn't.
Very well then.
My poor brother, carried off suddenly by a severe chill.
Yes, I quite get through there.
Well, I thought you said that Miss Cardew was a little too much involved with your brother Earnest. Won't you feel it's not a good deal?
Oh, that's all right. Cecily's not a silly, romantic girl. She has a capital appetite, takes long walks, and pays no attention at all in any of her lessons.
I would rather like to see you, Cecily.
And I shall take very good care you never do. She is excessively pretty and only just turned 18.
Have you told me, Quentin, yet that you have an excessively pretty ward who is only just 18?
One does not just blurt these things out to people. Besides, Gwendolyn and Cecily are destined to be extremely great friends. I bet you within an hour of their meeting they'll be calling each other sister.
Women only do that when they call each other a lot of other things first. Now, I tell you, what if it would take, guys, really, was this? We really must go and dress. Do you know the thing, sir?
No, it's all 18, nearly 7.
Well, I'm hungry.
I never knew you when you worked, Eleanor.
What should we do after dinner? Go to a theatre?
Oh, no. I loathe this.
Well, let us go to the club.
Oh, no, I hate talking.
Well, we might trot round to the Empire at 10.
Looking at things? No, that's so silly.
What should we do?
Nothing.
It's awfully hard work doing nothing. Well, I don't mind hard work when there's no definite object of any kind.
Miss Further.
Well, upon my word!
Now, you kindly turn your back out in great particular state, Mr. Worthing.
Really, Gwendolyn, I don't think I can allow the storm.
Bunbury is going to get you into a dire scrape one of these days.
I love scrapes. They are the only things that are never serious.
That is nonsense, Algernon. You never talk anything but nonsense.
Nobody ever does. Besides, I love nonsense.
Well, I've never met any really wicked person before. I feel rather frightened.
sleep at night.
Well, I hope you've not been leading a double life, pretending to be wicked and being really good all the time. That'd be hypocrisy.
Well, I suppose I have been rather reckless. In fact, now that you mention it, I've been very bad in my own school.
Well, I don't think you should be so proud of that. I'm sure it must have been very pleasant.
Not pleasant being here.
Well, I don't understand how you're here at all. I'll definitely be back to Monday afternoon.
That is a great disappointment. I'm obliged to go on my first train on Monday morning. I have a business appointment that I'm anxious to make.
Well,
I need to know.
Well, I know, of course, how important it is not to keep a business engagement if one wants to retain any sense of the beauty of life. But still, I think you'd better wait till Uncle Jack arrives. I know people just speak too much about emigrating. Uncle Jack is sending you to Australia.
Australia? I'd sooner die.
Well, he said dinner on Wednesday night that you'd have to choose between this world, the next world, and Australia.
This world is good enough for me, Cousin Cecily.
Yes.
But
are you good enough?
I'm not that. Which is why I want you to reform me, Cousin Cecily. You might make that my mission if you don't mind.
I'm afraid I've no time this afternoon.
Well, would you mind if I reformed myself this afternoon?
It's rather troubled of you. But I think you should try.
I will. I feel better already.
You're looking a little worse.
That's because I'm hungry.
Of course! I should remember that when one is going to lead an entire new life on quite regular and wholesome meals, we should come in.
Thank you.
You are too much alone, dear Dr. Chasuble. You should get married. See, you do not seem to realise, dear doctor. But, specifically, remain single. A man converts himself to a permanent public temptation.
Okay.
These are very joyful tidings.
Brothers in the day.
Well, I don't know what it all means.
It seems to me to be perfectly absurd.
Good head, brother! I've come down to the town sometimes. Very, very sorry for the trouble I've given you. But I intend to lead a better life in the future.
Uncle Jack, you're not going to refuse your own brother's hand.
Nothing will induce me to take his hand. His coming down here is disgraceful. He knows why.
I expect a more enthusiastic welcome, especially considering it's the first time I've come here.
Uncle Jack, if you do not shake hands with Earnest, I will never forgive you.
Never forgive me?
Never, never, never.
This is the last time I shall do it, then.
It is pleasant, is it not, to see so perfect a reconciliation? I think you might leave the two brothers alone.
Cecily? Cecily! You'll come with us!
Certainly.
You young scoundrel, Archie! You must leave this place at once! I won't allow you to bumbry in here!
Mr. Earnest,
what?
Mr. Earnest's luggage, sir, is in the room next
door. His luggage?
Yes, sir. Three portmanteaus, a dressing case, two hat boxes, and a large lunch.
I'm afraid I can't stay more than a week this time.
Merriman, order the dog cart at once. Mr. Earnest has been called back to town quite suddenly.
Yes.
Well, Cecily is a darling.
You are not to talk of Miss Hardy like that. I do not like it.
Well, I don't like your clothes.
You look perfectly ridiculous.
Why didn't you go and change? Scandalous to be deep mourning for a man who's actually stayed with you as a guest.
You are certainly not staying with me.
We're certainly not as a guest or as anything else.
I certainly won't leave so long as you are in mourning. Oh. If I was in mourning, you would stay with me, I suppose. I should think it very unkind if you did.
Well, if I change my clothes, would then go?
Yes, you're not too long. I never saw anyone take so long to dress with such little result.
At any rate, it is better than being constantly overdressed as you are.
If I'm occasionally a little overdressed, I make up for it by always being immensely overeducated.
Your vanity is ridiculous. Your conduct an outrage, and your presence in my garden completely absurd. But you have got to leave by the 4-5 train, and I hope you will have a most pleasant journey home.
This bumbling, as you call it, hasn't been a great success.
Well, I think it's been a great success. I'm in love with Cecily, and that's everything.
If you will allow me, I will copy your remarks into my diary.
You really keep a diary? And you then you can look at it. Now?
Oh, no! You see, it is simply a very look of the own thoughts and impressions. And consequently, meant for publication. When it comes out in the morning before, why do you go to the Mulder copy? Pray, Ernest, don't stop. I'm delighted to take you down from detention. I have reached absolute perfection. You can go on, I'm wondering for. Don't cough, Ernest. When one is dictating, one should speak fluently and not cough. Besides, I don't know much to spell it.
Cecily, ever since I first gazed upon your wild and incomparable beauty,
I've dared to love you wild.
Passion! Devotion!
Fairfax? I suppose one of the makers of Elgin would be quite associated with her. in some of his philanthropic work in London.
Mr. Fairfax!
On Saturday at the latest. 20 fools. I shall consider it my duty to rescue him at once and with a firm hand.
Well, whatever unfortunate entanglement my dear boy may have offered you, I will never approach it after we marry.
Do you allude to me, Miss Carter, as an entanglement?
Oh, you are presumptuous. On an occasion such as this, it becomes more than a moral to dispute one's mind. It becomes a pleasure.
What do you suggest, Miss Fair? That's my trap turn into an engagement. How dare you? No time for any shallow marks in that. When I see a thing, I call it a thing.
I might say that I have never seen a thing, as social spheres of obvious that they apply.
Shall all they be here as usual?
Yes, as usual. Algernon Moncrief!
I can deny anything if I like. But yes, it is John. It's been John for a very long time.
Muffins in an agitated manner. The butter will probably get on my nerves.
One should always eat muffins quite calm.
I say it is hard that you're eating muffins at all under the circumstances.
When I'm in trouble, it is the only thing that consoles me. Indeed, when I'm in really great trouble, I refuse everything except food and drink. At the present moment, I am eating muffins because I am unhappy. Besides, I'm deeply fond of muffins.
Well, that is no reason why I should eat more than that greedy man and answer.
I wish we had tea cake. I don't like tea cake.
Good heavens!
I suppose a man may eat his own muffins in his own garden.
But you have just said it was perfectly heartless to eat muffins.
No, I said it was perfectly heartless of you under the circumstances.
They are quite different things.
That
may be, but the muffins are
so... Well, Algernon, I do wish you'd just go.
You can't possibly ask me to go without having some dinner first. It's absurd. I never go without my dinner. No one ever does, except vegetarians or like that. Besides, I've just made arrangements with Dr. Chasuble under the name of Earnest.
My dear fellow, the sooner you give up that nonsense, the better. I myself have made arrangements with Dr. Chasuble to be christened myself at 5:30, and I, naturally, will take the name of Earnest. Gwendolyn would wish it. I think it extremely possible. I have never been christened anywhere before by anybody, and so does Dr. Chasuble. It is quite different in your case. You have been christened before.
Yes, but I've not been christened for years.
Yes, but you have been christened. That's the important thing.
Quite so. So I know my constitution can stand it. You're not sure about your own having been christened. I must say, I think it rather dangerous to venture on it now. It might make you very unwell. You could hardly have muscled someone very closely connected with you. It was very nearly carried up in Paris this week by a severe chill.
Yes, but you yourself said that a severe chill was not hereditary.
Oh, it used to be, I know, but I dare say it is now. Science is always making wonderful improvements in things.
Well, that is nonsense. You never call anything but nonsense. Jack!
You are the muffins again! Told you I was particularly fond of muffins.
Yes, but I hate tea cake.
Why on earth did you have tea cake to be served up for your guests?
What ideas you have of hospitality? Delgenot! I have already asked you to go. I don't want you here. Can you just leave?
I'll finish my tea here. There's still a few muffins left.
Have a brother.
But we were going to get prison this afternoon.
I am.
Please be, you are ready to face this fearful ordeal?
I am.
Oh, how absurd to talk of the equality of the sexes, where matters of self-sacrifice concern men are infinitely beyond us.
We are.
There are moments of physical courage of which we women know absolutely nothing. Darling.
Darling!
Living over. Oh!
Who cares?
Regret to say, in an age of surfaces.
sweetest girl in the whole world, and I don't care tuppence about social possibilities.
Never speak disrespectfully of society, Elgin.
Desire for immediate baptism.
Baptism? baptized. I will not hear of such excesses.
Am I to understand there are to be no christenings at all this afternoon?
I don't think, given the circumstances, it would practically benefit either of us, dear Doctor.
I am grieved to hear such sentiments from you, Mr. Worth. I will return to the church. Indeed, I was being bought by the pew for the past hour and a half.
Miss Prism, did I hear a mention of a Miss Prism?
Yes, Lady Bracknell. I am on my way to join her now.
Is this Miss Prism the female of repellent aspect remotely connected to education?
She's the most cultivated of these and the very picture of respectability.
It is obviously the same person. May I ask what position she holds in your household?
I am a celibate, madam.
Miss Prism, Lady Bracknell, has been for years Cecily's esteemed governess and honoured companion.
Well, despite all I hear of her, I must see her at once. Let her be sent for.
I was told you expected me in the vestry, dear Janet. I've been waiting for you there for about 3 quarters.
Prism! Come here, Prism. Prism? Where is that baby? 28 years ago, Prism, you left Lord Bracknell's house in charge of a perambulator that contained a baby of the male sex. You never returned. After a few weeks, though, through the elaborate investigations of the Metropolitan Police, the perambulator was discovered in a remote corner of Bayswater. In it contained a three-volume novel that contained a huge, more than usually revolting sentimentality. But the baby was not there. Prism, where is that baby?
Please, Brad, admit with shame that I do not know. I wish I did. The plain fact of the case of ease on the morning of the day mentioned. I prepared, as usual, to take the baby out of its perambulator. I had also with me a somewhat old but capacious handbag in which I had intended to place a work of fiction I had written during my few unoccupied hours. And in a moment of mental abstraction, I placed the manuscript in the bassinet. The baby!
Miss Prism, where did you deposit the handbag?
Don't ask me, Mr. Prism!
Miss Prism, I insist. This is a matter of no small importance to me. I must know the location of the handbag in which you contain that infant.
Oh, I left it in a cloakroom of one of the larger railway stations just
us. Yes, but which railway station?
Victoria! The bride's alive!
I must retire to my room for a minute. Gwendolyn,
you will wait for me.
Oh, if you are not too long, I will wait here for all my life.
What do you think it means, Lady Rappin?
I dare not be confessed, gentlemen.
Uncle Jack, it's strangely agitated.
Your heart here has a very emotional name.
The noise is extremely unpleasant. Sounds so troublesome to such an artist. I dislike artists of any kind. They are always vulgar and often
twisted. Just stop now.
Oh, this suspense is terrible. I hope it will last.
Is this the handbag? Please, examine it carefully. The happiness of more than one life depends on your reply.
united to you from just this handbag. I was the infant you placed in.
You?
Yes.
I always told you, Gwendolyn, didn't I, that my name was Earnest?
Well, it naturally is Earnest!
It's my own eyes! I felt the first you have no other name!
Gwendolyn, it is a terrible pain for a man to learn that all his life he has been speaking nothing but the truth. Can you ever forgive me?
I can. For I feel it's a short change.
My own one.
Darling.
Natasha.
Pretty.
At last.
Cecily. At last.
Gwendolyn. At last.
Thank you.
Quite the contrary, Aunt Augusta. For the first time in my life, I have realized the vital importance of being earnest.